ਮਾਨਯ ਸਭਾਸਦ ਮਾਨਯ ਉਪ ਸਭਾਪਤੀ ਜੀ
Now, supplementary demands for Grand Railways, Sri Suresh Prabhu to lay on the table. Lay on the table.
Yes. I beg to lay on the table a statement in English and Hindi showing the supplementary demands for Grants, Railways 2016-17.
Statement by Minister on Srimati Sushma Swaraj.
Thank you, Deputy Chairman, sir. Honorable Deputy Chairman, sir, I rise to respond to the issue raised by Honorable Member Kanimulji and honorable other members of this house regarding an incident of firing on Indian fishermen in Park Bay. At the outset, Deputy Chairman, sir, let me take this opportunity to reiterate in no uncertain terms that our government attaches the highest importance to the safety, security and welfare of Indian fishermen. Government, through diplomatic channels, has consistently taken up issues relating to apprehension of our fishermen with the government of Sri Lanka to ensure that our fishermen are treated in a humane manner. According to our information, the referred matter relates to the incident in Park Bay at around 22:30 hours on 6th March 2017, in which a fishing vessel from Tamil Nadu was fired upon, allegedly by the Sri Lankan Navy, leading to the death of an Indian fisherman. Another fisherman was also injured. After the incident was reported, the government, through diplomatic channels, took up the matter urgently with the government of Sri Lanka and expressed our strong concern over the incident. The Sri Lankan side has, however, denied the involvement of their navy in the firing incident. Our High Commissioner personally spoke to Sri Lankan Prime Minister and Navy Commander on this matter. The Sri Lanka Navy, however, maintained that their patrol boats are not authorized to open fire at any point on Indian fishermen, even if they are transgressing into the Sri Lankan waters. Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Sri Lanka, in separate statement, conveyed their deep concern over the alleged firing and loss of life, reiterating the commitment of the government of Sri Lanka to ensure that all government agencies treat Indian fishermen in a humane manner at all times. The Sri Lankan government has further reassured us that all possible action will be taken in cooperation with the relevant Indian authorities to investigate the incident. President of Sri Lanka also conveyed to our Vice President in their meeting in Jakarta on 7th March 2017 on the sidelines of the Indian Ocean Rim Association Leaders Summit his regret at the unfortunate incident and the loss of life. He emphasized that he has ordered a full investigation. We will be pursuing this matter with the Sri Lankan government. Deputy Chairman, sir, it is because of the priority attached to this issue by our government that the fishermen issues were raised at the highest level, including by our Prime Minister in his meetings with the Sri Lankan President in the last 2 years. We consider the matter as essentially humanitarian in nature, involving the livelihood and socio-economic practices of our fishermen community. Both leaders had called for finding a permanent solution to the matter. I have also discussed the matter in great detail with the Sri Lankan Foreign Minister during my visit to Colombo in February 2016, when we co-chaired the 9th meeting of the India-Sri Lanka Joint Commission. We have since then steadfastly worked towards finding a permanent solution to the matter. Deputy Chairman, sir, last November, based on the feedback, I, along with our Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries, held a bilateral ministerial meeting with Sri Lanka in New Delhi to discuss the issue in a comprehensive matter. I also had a meeting with the Fishermen's Association on this issue. I would like to share with the August House that an agreement was reached at the meeting to set up a joint working group on fisheries as a bilateral institutional mechanism to help find a permanent solution to all fishermen issues. It was also agreed that ministers for fisheries of the two countries meet every 6 months to review the progress. The first meeting of the JWG on fisheries was held in New Delhi on 31st December 2016, and the first ministerial meeting was held on 2nd January 2017 in Colombo. The JWG agreed to set up a confidence-building measure, which included an understanding to ensure that there was no physical harm or loss of life while apprehending fishermen by Navy and Coast Guard of the two countries. Deputy Chairman, sir, government, as a result of its consistent efforts, has secured release of 1,045 Indian fishermen in custody of Sri Lanka in 2014, 375 fishermen in 2015, 333 fishermen in 2016, and 51 fishermen in 2017, while 85 Indian fishermen, along with 136 fishing vessels, were in custody of Sri Lanka. I'm glad to inform the House that all the fishermen have since been released. 77 fishermen returned to India day before yesterday, and as I speak, the rest of the 8 are on their way back to India. We are also pursuing the release of the fishing boats in Sri Lankan custody. I would again like to reassure the Honourable Members that the Government of India accords the highest priority to promote the well-being, safety and security of our fishermen. We have strongly conveyed to Sri Lanka that the use of force cannot be justified under any circumstances. Deputy Chairman, sir, the government continues to remain engaged with the government of Sri Lanka to ensure that the rights of the detained Indian nationals are protected and that the fishermen on both sides can continue to pursue their livelihood in a safe, secure and sustainable manner. Thank you.
No, no. This is a statement on demand, no clarification. This is a statement on demand.
Mr. Yeah. I'm making a statement. Please have patience. I'm making a separate statement on the issue raised by you.
Let the minister listen.
That has not been distributed. Only this one has been distributed, but I'm making a statement on the issue raised by you that day about fishermen in Pakistan's custody.
Huh. Are you doing it now?
Yes.
Yes, please do it.
Deputy Chairman, sir, I would like to respond to the issue raised by, Honourable Member Madhusudan Mistry by saying that government has been regularly taking up the matter of consular access, early release and repatriation of the apprehended Indian fishermen in the custody of Pakistan's authorities at various levels. We have institutionalized the mechanism of sharing information about the prisoners, including fishermen, in each other's custody through a bilateral protocol in 2008. Under this, list of prisoners, including fishermen, are exchanged on 1st January and 1st July every year. Last such exchange of lists took place on 1st January 2017. Due to the persistent efforts of the government, we have been able to secure the release and repatriation of 1,261 fishermen since 2014. In fact, the release of 438 of these Indian fishermen was secured in the last 3 months only. As per available information, presently there are 301 Indian fishermen in Pakistan's custody. However, Pakistan has confirmed custody of only 77 fishermen so far. We continuously seek consular access to the Indian fishermen in custody and distribute to them the items of daily necessity as required. Deputy Chairman, sir, it has been brought to our attention that many incidents of apprehensions take place beyond the international waters. In this context, under the Community Interaction Program, regular awareness campaigns are conducted by the Indian Coast Guards in coordination with the State Fisheries Department to educate the fishermen about the limits of the International Maritime Boundary Line, that is IMBL. Emphasis has also been laid on the need for fishing in safe, secure and sustainable environment. The Indian Coast Guards have also been undertaking enhanced patrolling in the Indian waters, including to safeguard the interests of the Indian fishermen and keep them out of harm's way. The government continues to monitor the status of the Indian fishermen in Pakistan custody with a view to secure their early release and repatriation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No. See, Rajaji, this is a statement made on the, because there was a demand for the statement. The other day, Kanimudi Ji, Tiruchi Sivan, and then Mr. Mistry, and then I myself directed that there should be a statement. So there we cannot have clarification. So that is the practice here, you know. So if it is a Suomoto statement, no, what can I do? We have to take up the discussion. Not only if I allow no clarification, everybody will ask. Not only that, we have to take up the discussion. No, that you see,
Sir,
you see, you
from the Pakistan
Marine. No, that's correct.
Repeatedly.
But Mistry, you
were captured by Pakistan Marine, the leader of the house
no,
from
listen.
Gujarat, sir. He has never
no,
uttered a word about
no,
Mistry
ji, no,
I
no, no.
To know what happened.
You cannot blame, no. You raised it and the government responded to it. Sushma Swaraj was kind enough to respond to you. And then now, how can you blame? No, no, no. No, no. I am not allowing clarification. We have to take up discussion. No, no. If, no, no, I know if I... See? No, no. But how many? How many? What do I do? I have to take up...
Already given name, sir.
No, you have given name, but I cannot stop with you.
Rightly said that clarifications are sought only when a minister makes a suo-motu statement in the House and not when a minister replies to a discussion or issues raised in the House. But if the honourable members really want to ask the clarifications, I can request
but I am
you.
Not allowing.
No, then I request you that please fix another date for clarifications.
I
am ready for that.
Yeah. That
ready
is
for
okay. That's okay. I have no problem with that.
I am ready for that.
Yeah. I have no problem with that. Yeah, I see, I must thank the Honorable Minister for so being so generous. The generous. And also responded to the members' demand. I think this is a good example. See, this is a good example. We must all thank her. She responded to the 2-hour submission of two members and thank you very much.